So thank you. I'd like to express my thanks, first of all, to Sasha, to the organizers for inviting me to be here in Sirius. It's a pleasure. Now, get to the talk. I would like to share with you some knowledge, and maybe rather than that, lack of knowledge about some very special polynomial approximations. Polynomials are very special. So f of d indices, it's a polynomial, and it depends on many variables in a very special way. In a very special way, like what I'm writing now. And probably I need some index here. So alpha runs from 1 to some number. So all these things are variables. So we have many polynomials depending on quite a few variables. All these values can be arranged in one vector. So we may consider a multi-index, then f can be considered as a vector. And this thing can be written using the well-known Kronecker product of vectors. So this sum is the sum of vectors. Each vector is represented as a Kronecker product. Of smaller vectors. Okay. Oh, yes. So this vector is of size, say, n1. This vector is of size, say nd. And the size of this vector is the product of n1 to n to nd. So this polynomials are very are used in quite many applications. Usually, people call this tensor because it is a representation of some tensor. And this Kronecker product is, of course, tensor product. So it's just some realization of the concept of a tensor space. Now the main problem. Main, of course, main, it is called as main. So I'd like to consider the case of just three indices, to show the problem. One definition before that, the definition of rank. So the rank of this tensor is called the minimal number of summons in such kind of representations. So this is the rank. So we consider all numbers complex numbers. And now the main problem. The main problem. Let's consider a very special tensor, a vector, like I will write. B, you see symmetry here. So some people call it Laplacian because it reminds you some discretization form of Laplacian. A and B are two vectors. So let's ask, so what is the rank of this tensor with the closure in the usual topology, complex valued tensors here. And xk is a polynomial, is an image of a polynomial mapping. This x, this is the reason why these two closures coincide in this case. And now, what numerical analysts and other people also from algebraic geometry say? They say that these sets are not closed, starting from 2 and further. And because it is related with the main problem for computations, I decided to find the proof. And I failed to do this. So I was, yes, I was not able to find the proof of that statement. This is a counterexample. There are some other counterexamples, but the proof for me, it appeared a kind of problem to be able to say that in general, it is, we have this theorem. So I started to think about that, and I'd like to tell you about that thinking. So first of all, about this first counter Laplacian. This can be extended a little bit. This result can be extended. I may consider a G-dimensional kind of Laplacian. What I mean by kind of Laplacian? We can consider G vectors, A and G vectors B, and assume that each pair is linearly independent, each pair. And then I can construct So TD will be how to explain what this is. But on some places is B. First place is B, then second place B, and so we have D terms. So the theorem that can be proved is this. So if for each alpha this pair is linearly independent, then the rank of this is equal to D. Well, it needs some thinking. It needs some thinking. Once I asked one of my students to check it on the computer system using computer algebra. Mm-hmm. So it's possible. And the system proved that for d equal to 4, the rank is 4. But for d equal to 5, computer no, he was going to work for infinite time. Infinite time. So the brain is much more powerful.
Everybody knows that.
Yes. But it's also the usefulness of conferences. I discussed this question once with Martin Mohlenkamp. He's a very brilliant guy. And after that discussion, it became clear how it can be proved. So it's one of the results. So it gives another counterexample. But now, how about the general statements? The general statement. Well, maybe before I tell that, this will be my main purpose, I will tell you about another counterexample, another counterexample that belongs to my friend, very nice mathematician, Dario Bini, from Pisa in Italy. He told me about that. Another counterexample. Consider tensors, n by n by n, and define a tensor by its slices, its slices. So we need to set n slices.
What do you mean by slice?
The slices, we fix the last index. And the slice is a matrix in this case. So this n matrix is n by n, each one. So they define the tensor. And now we consider a very nice tensor. Slices like this. A1 is identity. But then this diagonal moves one position and okay, so the last one like this. So if we sum up the slices, we obtain an upper triangular matrix with unities in each position. So Dario Bini was able to prove that the rank of such a tensor is equal, is not equal, is not less than to n minus 1. So Yes. It is a very elegant proof, not a very big one, but elegant proof of this. Maybe I.
So there is no chances to get something.
No. But this tensor is a limit of tensors of rank n. And for me, it's also very interesting because how this fact appears. Look, what we do. We put epsilon below. So there's something here, and we put epsilon below.
How you put it? Epsilon.
So, okay.
Everywhere.
Yes.
Everywhere.
No, not everywhere.
Under the diagonal. Under the main diagonal.
Every non-zero element that appears below the diagonal is multiplied by epsilon.
Every non-zero.
So now what we have, each slice in this case turns out to be epsilon circulant. And it's not a big deal to prove that every epsilon circulant has the same basis of eigenvectors.
So what is epsilon?
Okay, it's circulant. 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 Yes. Okay, so look. Okay, look. This is the first column, then we shift in a cyclic fashion. Yes. And now put epsilon here. So for any epsilon, this matrix is diagonalizable, and the set of eigenvectors is the same. It depends on epsilon, but it does not depend on A. So all this section, this epsilon approximation, in this epsilon approximation, all the section, all the slices are simultaneously diagonalizable. And it follows from this that the rank is equal to n. It's quite easy to do. So we have another counterexample. Yeah. So we have a sequence of tensors of rank n, but the limit has rank like this. Like this. One question that I consider very interesting and open, what is the maximal value of the rank of the limits? Of course, I put this question not only for tensors of size n by n, so it depends on the sizes. It depends on the sizes. It's not easy to understand what can we have. But now, I get to my main my main purpose. So we have two counterexamples, two counterexamples, but these are still counterexamples. And how to understand the unclosedness? Or maybe it's not true. Who knows? No. The counterexample exists, but the claim is that for each car greater than one, this set is unclosed. I believe open still. What can I do? I can take this tensor, for example, I can say Laplacian, and add some rank one tensor to increase the rank. And do it several times. And if this is possible, then I'm able to prove unclosedness for each k. Now, I'd like to share with you my conjecture, which is still a conjecture. So rank increment conjecture. Well, here. So we have for each tensor of rank strictly less than, well, maybe maximal or maybe generic. It's okay. Generic rank is the following thing. So each complex tensor, there is a number, mm-hmm. and each with probability one, mm-hmm. Each tensor has this value of rank.
But for our settings. But say it's n or.
No.
For our
setting? Yes. For our setting, for n by n by n, it's yes. possible. Yes. It's possible to say. If n equals 3, it is 5.
And for others?
For others, there is another conjecture, okay. which is not proved.
No.
But it exists.
So we understand.
Yes. Yeah. So now my generic, them, no, generic. So I believe also for maximal it's possible to say the same. But it's enough to do this for generic. There exists a tensor T of rank 1 such that for each tensor, I should say A, that rank A plus T bigger, of course, how much bigger? By 1, of course.
Equal,
of course, because it can't increase more than, yeah. than by one. So it looks absolutely natural. So for any tensor of not maximal or maybe in slightly weaker form, less than generic, there is a tensor of rank one such that after addition the rank increases. And so my claim is that I am not able to prove this.
Yes.
But the last thing I want to say, what I can prove, what I proved. I proved that algebraically almost each tensor, algebraically almost each means that this probability one. With probability one, this is true. No, check. I proved. I proved. With probability one, this my conjecture is true. Moreover, I proved even a little bit more. With probability one, it holds that a rank 1 tensor exists such that after addition, we obtain the tensor of increased rank, which is not a limit of any sequence of tensors of lesser rank. So this is proved, but with probability 1. But my conjecture is that we can get rid of the probability 1. So it's it should be true for any tensor. And if it is proved that we can state that all these sets are unclosed.
Okay, unfortunately, we have to stop here.
But I told everything I wanted.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Please, if there are questions, maybe just one question, because we are already out of time. So, please.
Which measure for probability you use?
Well, it's just a Lebesgue measure.
So, we
can use that.
Okay, but please, very short question.
For numerics, I think it's a pure interest because the claim is that this unclosedness, the effect of Wöder rank, is an obstacle for numerical computations. I believe this is so. So if I prove this conjecture, it will not help the numerical computations, of course.
No,
but understanding of the picture.
Yes, you should know.
Yes, I want to understand the whole picture here.
Okay, thank you very much. We, unfortunately, we have no time for questions, so let's thank you.